go and where I'm going to
go. I'm going to go slow, okay? But then as it gets closer to coming after, we're going to go a little faster. Okay, so here is our blood vessel. Here's our dermis up here, our epidermis. Here we have Langerhans cells. Right. We've got fibroblasts, we have mast cells, we have macrophages. Got some more fibroblasts over here. Okay. And then out here we've got things like peripheral dendritic cells.
And then let's say over here we got a cytotoxic T cell. This T cell is coming into the area with its TCR. It hasn't docked yet. Okay. In the vascular system, we've got our neutrophils and all of our other blood cells moving through. So now the neutrophil, we're gonna look at the margination diabetes first, but before that, we're actually gonna injure the area. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna lacerate the tissue. We've got a laceration of tissue. We've done it with a dirty implement that has pathogens on it. So now these pathogens have gotten inside the cell. These pathogens are going to start to produce a chemotactic signal. But let's say the laceration was deep enough that we've damaged the endothelium. When we damage the endothelium, we've exposed the subendothelial layer. When we expose the subendothelial layer, had a molecule called von Willebrand's factor. So we've got von Willebrand's factor, and that's going to bind with glycoprotein 1B. All right, and then that's going to be on the thrombocyte. When that happens, the thrombocyte is going to granulate and release
ADP.
ADP is going to flip back around on itself and on other cells, and it's going to activate the release of thromboxane A2. Thromboxane A2 is going to kick in and activate glycoprotein 2B3A. Okay, good. Which cross links with fibrinogen. All right. And then once I activate that, because I damage the tissue, I'm going to activate the extrinsic pathway, which releases tissue factor. Tissue factor then is going to kickstart and convert factor 10 into factor active 10A, so Stuart-Crower into active Stuart-Crower. And that's going to convert one into what? Okay, so prothrombin, thrombin, and then thrombin is going to convert fibrinogen into fibrin, and also plasminogen into plasmin. All right. So there we've got our blood clot that's starting to form, okay? And the nice thing about it is P-selectin, what does P-selectin stand for? Platelet selectin. So even if I don't express the P-selectin here, I can't have the P-selectin on the platelet, or on the thrombus, whatever that platelet is. Anyway, so I've done that. Now, when I injured this, this sent out this chemotactic signal. Now, some of these bacterial byproducts are gonna cause mast cell degranulation. And so with the mast cell degranulation, what's gonna happen is I'm gonna release histamine. Okay, because I've activated adjacent IgE antibodies. That histamine is going to do what? H1 receptors. Okay, so here's my H1 receptors. And then once histamine plugs in, it's going to cause what to happen?
Calcium
comes in, activates myosin light chain kinase. These cells are going to separate from each other. I just have increased permeability. But the other thing I activated was INOS. So had calcium come in, that activated INOS. INOS is going to activate nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is going to come over here and increase cyclic GMP. Cyclic GMP is going to activate myosin light chain phosphatase, but I'm going to get relaxation. Okay, so now I've had my vasodilation increase permeability, but the other thing that happened is when I had my vasodilation, I increased the hydrostatic pressure in the capillary, which brought more flow through here, but also brought more neutrophils in here, and that's exactly what I wanted, right? But I've also, I've lost some of the oncotic pressure of the capillary because it's now becoming the oncotic pressure of the interstitial fluid, and I'm dropping the pressure there. Is that a bad thing that I'm losing these proteins? No, because over here, if I look at some of the proteins, what are some of the proteins that I've lost? Some of the complement proteins, right? And so these complement proteins, C3 is breaking down, and C3 is breaking down into this, C3B. So there's my C3B, but also C3A. Well, C3B, that's great, because over here I have a CR1 receptor that can grab a hold of that C3B. Also, if I've been exposed to these bacteria before, I might have antibodies to it. And if I have antibodies, there's the crystalline fragment, I've got an FCR receptor. So that's great. I don't even have to get the neutrophils out there yet. However, I'm getting the neutrophils out there because these bacteria have this binary fission. Now, the chemical signaling is also stimulated to fibroblasts. The fibroblasts are starting to wall off this area with collagen fibers. It's also attracting the peripheral dendritic cells in the area, so they're starting to move into the area. Now, the neutrophils, now once I've activated the macrophage is going to go ahead and release TNF-alpha, IL-1, and IL-8. IL-1 is going to circulate, it's going to cause the release of the acute phase protein, so I get even more fibrinogen, complement proteins, et cetera, et cetera. But also, IL-1 is going to reset your hypothalamic thermostat, so you're going to get a fever. TNF-alpha is going to come down here, and it's going to plug into these cells, and what are they going to express?
Peace.
Okay, so now I'm going to, so TNF-alpha stimulates the expression of P-selectin. Now, on here, I have a selectin ligand, so I'm going to take my P-slig, okay, and I'm going to bind that, so my selectin ligand, I'm going to bind that to the P-selectin molecule. That, in association with IL-8, because IL-8 is going to come over here, and IL-8 is going to be held out right here on this cell. So here's IL-8. IL-8 is also going to be called CXCR8. Okay, same thing. That's a chemokine. So chemokines tell this neutrophil where to go, but the chemokine also, in association with P-selectin, activated what on the neutrophil?
The beta-2 integrin.
So now I've activated the beta-2 integrin. The beta-2 integrin now can grab a hold of the ICAM. So it's going to flip over here. Now I've docked the neutrophil onto the cell, onto the ICAM. Now once I've done that, what's that process called?
Margination.
So now I've got margination taking place. The neutrophil is going to come over here, and when it finds the CXCR8, it's going to move out, and that's called what?
Diapedesis.
Now, as it's moving out, it's starting to take in oxygen. It's taking in oxygen because it's increasing its amount of superoxide free radicals and H2O2. Because when it comes into this area, the neutrophil came in this area, but it's not going to leave. It's going to go in there, and it's going to kill itself off. Because what it's going to do is it's going to start grabbing bacteria and eating them, but it only can eat about 8 to 18 bacteria. After that, it's going to use what's called oxidative and non-oxidative killing. Non-oxidative killing involves what?
Lysosomes.
Okay, so non-oxidative involves the lysosomes. Oxidative involves the peroxisomes. Bottom line is it went in there, but it's not leaving. So it's basically liquefied this tissue area. So these neutrophils keep pouring in and pouring in and pouring in. In the meantime, the macrophage has grabbed a hold of this bacteria with, let's say, either the CR1 or the FCR, and now when it grabbed a hold of that, it's going to do something. It's going to take that in, it's going to break it down, and now it's going to express it on what?
MHC2.
So now it's holding these proteins out, okay? Because these are the proteins that were on here. Okay, so now it's holding those out, and it's going to upregulate another type of protein. What's the other type of protein called? B7. So it upregulates MHC2, it's upregulates B7. At this point, the macrophage is going to become the antigen-presenting cell. Okay, so what it's going to do is it's going to actively look for a lymph node. So here it is, it's crawling into this lymph node. Now in the meantime, let's say that this pathogen went intracellular. Let's say that the same pathogen that was taken by the macrophage has snuck over here, and it's gone into this cell right here. It's become an intracellular pathogen. This pathogen, this fibroblast is going to take it, and let's say it's a virus. If it's a virus, what is this fibroblast going to secrete? It's going to secrete what? INF. And what does INF do? If it's type 1, INF type 1 will go over to this cell and it'll say make antiviral proteins, right? But if it's type 2, it'll call in peripheral dendritic cells to actually eat the cell. But anyway, this TC cell comes over here, it docks on this MHC1, and as it docks on this MHC1, it reaches over and grabs a hold of it with another protein called what?
CD8.
So now it grabs it with its CD8, and it goes, man, that shouldn't be there. But it can't do anything. That's just the first signal it needs. The second signal hasn't shown up yet, because where's the second signal coming from? It's going to come to the Th2 cell, but we don't have it, or Th1 cell, but we don't have a Th1 cell yet. However, this macrophage is going to come into the lymph node. So here comes the macrophage, the antigen-presenting cell, into the lymph node. It has its MHC2, right? It's going to find a THO cell that's naive. So it comes up, it finds this naive THO cell, it's going to show it its antigen. The THO cell is going to reach over and it's going to dock with the CD4 protein. It reads that and it goes, oh, I recognize that as non-cell. But it also needs this interaction. It needs the B7 to its CD28. Okay? So over here, this was the first signal needed for TC CD8 cell activation. This was the first signal needed for TH CD4 activation. There's its second signal. Now, if it gets those, it's also waiting for another signal, and let's say in this case it's IL-12. If it gets IL-12, this THO cell is now going to become a Th2 cell. That Th2 cell is going to, I'm sorry, Th1 cell, that Th1 cell is going to produce IL-2. Okay? IL-2 is what's needed for this to be activated. IL-2 is going to circulate in the blood, and then IL-2 is going to leach out in this area, and that activates that cell. Now that cell is going to disengage, and it's going to form about 7,000 to 10,000 cytotoxic T cells. But this process takes about 7 days, 6 to 7 days, okay? And so as soon as that happens, you get these TC cells that have the TCRs that have high specificity for that single antigen. But wait, there's more, okay? Because remember we said that the peripheral dendritic cells are also coming in? So the peripheral dendritic cells are coming in, but also the natural killer cells. And as natural killer cells and peripheral dendritic cells come in, they're going to produce an IL-4. And so let's show you what happens there. Let's say that in the lymph node, we've got this B cell right here. So here's this B cell, it's naive, right? It's just hanging out. It's got its BCR receptors up here. And the BCR receptors have IgM and IgD, right? Well, so the research differs on this. Some say that as these cells are killed off, it's the sediment and the antigen. But others say the peripheral dendritic cells actually come in, or the follicular dendritic cells actually get it. What's happening is we're getting captains in here, so we're getting reactivity, but we're also getting immunogenicity. So the B cell is going to cap, it's going to take this in. It's going to take this whole process in, okay, this whole big cluster here, okay? It's going to take it in, it's going to fuse it with the lysosome. Now, it retrieved the protein from outside the cell. It didn't make it on the inside, so what is it going to present now? MHC2. So now it has an MHC2 that it's presenting it on, because now it's become the antigen-presenting cell. What it's looking for is it's looking for a Th2 cell. It's already been activated. Now, it's presenting that to the TCR on that cell. This cell is going to reach over and it's going to grab. So here's my antigen right here. It's going to grab with the CD4. But this is a much more complex process. The other thing is I've upregulated these B7 proteins. That's going to dock on the CD28. Now at this point, I've had my first signal here. And now I'm going to initiate my second signal. Because on the cell right here, what I have is I have a CD40 receptor. But if this is a match and this is a match, the Th2 cell will express what protein?
CD40L.
So now it's going to express a CD40L. That CD40L is going to ligate the CD40. At this point, the Th cell is also going to secrete IL-4, 5, and 6. As it secretes IL-4, 5, and 6, that is going to stimulate the antigen-presenting cell to become what? plasma cells and memory cells. So now the cell is going to become memory cells, and it's also going to become plasma cells. And I'm going to get about 500 of these plasma cells for every single cell that I stimulate. These plasma cells are going to produce all five classes of antibodies. So here's my antibodies. Now they're going to start to circulate, and so now I'm increasing my antibody titer in serum, and as they circulate, what they do is they leak out of these permeable areas and they just saturate the interstitium. So they're showing up in about 5 days. And that's good because I'm going to saturate this before my T cells start killing. Because when these T cells start killing, they're going to actually release the viruses, but the viruses are going to be capped off. Hey, and look at this. This is an antibody, and macrophages have FCR receptors to pick up the FC region of the antibody. All right, any questions?
Yeah?
I'm sorry, what's it?
Like
when you get like an injury and you get, you know, is
that not?
Yeah, that's just the neutrophils that are going. Because when you pull a splinter out, if you got a splinter that goes in there deep and then you get that little white area, and a few days later that you're squeezing it and then you work that splinter out and all that exudate that comes out, that's because these neutrophils, they've liquefied that area. So, is there anything we left out from your poster?
Yes.
Okay.
Pyrogen?
Okay, so pyrogens. This is my pyrogen right here. IL-1 is your pyrogen. Pyrogen means generate fire. Okay?
Perforin?
Yeah. Okay, so what's happening is when the T cells kill, they're releasing granules of perforin. Oh, I lost one. So we're releasing these granules, which poke holes in the cell, and then granzymes come in and cause apoptosis of the cells.
So TC also relieves a granzyme?
Yeah. Along, what's the other cell that does the same thing? Because we have a cell that comes in here, because let's say that this cell doesn't have an MHC1, but it's infected, it's late stage infection, and it doesn't even produce the MHC1s anymore. What cell's going to find that one? Natural killer cells. Because the natural killer cells, they're looking for the absence of MHC1 receptors. And then they're going to kill those. Anything else we left off?
SLRG.
SLIG? Yeah. So P-SLIG is just the that's just the binding. Anything else we left off there?
What about the attack complex?
Okay, the membrane attack complex. So up here, I've got this. So I've let these complement proteins out here. Now, here's a concept to understand. If it's the first time I've had this infection, the first time I've been exposed to this, I don't do that, I only do that, right? So the first pathway always to be activated in the first time infection is gonna be the alternative pathway. The classical pathway only gets activated the second time in the infection or late in an infection. Because if it's late in an infection, after 4 to 5 days, then I can activate the classical pathway. I need two adjacent antibodies to bind onto a pathogen. That's going to activate C1. C1 activates C4, which activates C2, which activates C3. C3 becomes a C3 convertase, and I form more C3B molecules. Now I've got some options. I can either use my CR1 to grab my C3B, I can use my FCR to grab the FC on here, or I can activate C5. If I activate C5, I convert C5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, and they just come in here and start poking holes in the bacteria ruptures. Also, C5A that's produced is my strongest inflammatory chemokine. So, Miriam, what I'd suggest you do is, not all that's going to fit on a 3x5 card. So, what I would do is do yourself a favor. I would draw this out, just draw until you've got it. And then draw this out, just draw until you've got it. And just keep drawing these processes out because that's the best way to remember this stuff. Because on the exam, there's gonna be questions. It's like what stimulates the release of the P selection, the expression of P selection, or what step happens right before the expression of thromboxin A2. So just keep drawing these things out. Have you guys done the posters yet? Most of you?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. So we've got
15 minutes. Do you have any questions at all on blood or immunoassays? What's that?
Heparin.
Yeah, so here's what happens is
the mast cells contain histamine, the mast cells also contain heparin. Now, let's think about that. Why do you want mast cells to secrete heparin? Because heparin's an anticoagulant. It activates antithrombin, so I can't form.
I did my coagulation cascade.
Yeah, because I just increased permeability to get the neutrophils in there, but I'm also leaking out these proteins into an area of tissue factor. If these proteins leak out into an area of tissue factor, I'm going to start forming a clot in this area. Heparin is going to make sure that I don't form the clot in this area so the neutrophils can actually gain access. Because we talked about what happens with,
if you actually can make a clot, because we talked about the bacteria produce coagulase, right? Here we talked about that. I think we did. Talk about coagulase, hyaluronidase, collagenase. Was it the other class? Okay, so let me just show you. Bacteria, the bacteria that didn't used to kill you are now killing you. We've talked about the concept that we're at the end of antibiotics. That pretty much we've used, our antibiotics are becoming ineffective. And so we have to look at other things. And not only are antibiotics becoming more ineffective, bacteria are becoming more virulent. Bacteria getting new enzymes. And so Staphylococcus aureus and Streptococcus pyogenes, when they break through the skin, in fact, Streptococcus pyogenes means that, Streptococcus just means round, strep means a strip, but what does pyogenes mean? Pyo means pus, genes means genesis of pus. When you look at somebody with a strep throat, they have pus pockets in the back of their throat. Why? Because Streptococcus pyogenes has an enzyme called coagulase. Coagulase, what it does is it converts fibrinogen into fibrin and it locks itself down. So all of a sudden the bacteria gets in, it locks itself down, it walls itself off. The neutrophils show up, but they can't gain access to the bacteria. The bacteria divides and divides and divides and divides. Hydrostatic pressure is causing these pus pockets to form. And then as soon as it reaches saturation, we talk about quorum sensing here, right? We talk about quorum sensing. Can you talk about quorum sensing? Okay, steal the glass again. Anyway, quorum sensing is this. You've been to meetings before and they look around and go, do we have a quorum, right? What that means is, are there enough people here to be effective? Well, bacteria do what's called quorum sensing. If I'm the first bacteria, what I'm doing is I'm producing these little molecules in there. I'm secreting it and they're coming around and they're plugging back into surface receptors on it. Well, if I'm the only one there, I'm not activating all my receptors. But if I divide, 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 pretty soon all these bacteria producing all these molecules are activating all my receptors. At that point, I have quorum sensing. I realize that I'm not alone anymore. Well, what I'll do is I'll switch out my coagulase and produce kinase. Did we talk about staphylokinase, streptokinase? You know about anything. That was the other class. Staphylokinase and streptokinase. These are called clot busters. You actually used to give these clinically. If somebody came with a stroke, you'd give them staphylokinase or streptokinase because it would break the clot. But then they stopped giving it. The reason why is because they had to differentiate. Was it an ischemic stroke or hemorrhagic stroke? If it was a hemorrhagic stroke, and this killed the person. It just opened up the clot. If it was an ischemic stroke, great. You did fine. But what clot busters do is they convert converted plasminogen into plasma. So streptokinase is produced by Streptococcus pyogenes. Staphylokinase is produced by Staphylococcus aureus. They convert plasminogen to plasmin and they break down the clot. Well, why did they do that? Because now they have the numbers. There's this huge amount. And now what they're going to do is they're going to produce two other enzymes, collagenase and hyaluronidase. What would collagenase do? Look at this. The fibroblasts lay down collagen to keep it from spreading. All of a sudden, boom, it just broke down that collagen. And now it's starting to spread. And then hyaluronidase. Do you remember where hyaluronic acid was formed? Anybody remember where hyaluronic acid is formed? Or where what hyaluronic acid is part of? The glycosaminoglycans. What were glycosaminoglycans? So glycosaminoglycans were the branches on the proteoglycans, right? Okay, so hyaluronic acid is a primary type of glycosaminoglycan. You find it in stuff like cartilage. In cartilage, you have a viscous tissue with low permeability, right? If I'm looking at connective tissue proper, the more proteoglycans I have, the more viscous the tissue, the lower the permeability. So here all of a sudden I have this enzyme that actually breaks down proteoglycans. What's going to happen to the viscosity of this tissue? So the viscosity of the tissue is going to, and what's going to happen to the permeability? Permeability increases, viscosity decreases, and that allows the bacteria to spread. So these bacteria can do stuff like this, cause necrotizing fasciitis. So this is necrotizing fasciitis. Oh, that's a nasty one. That's a new one. Anyway, but when you look at these pictures, that's necrotizing fasciitis. But guess what? This is a surgical debridement. That's a surgical line that they cut because the necrotizing fasciitis started here. And what took place is that bacteria is producing collagenase and hyaluronidase. That skin's going to fall off anyway. And so what the physician does is they just go ahead and remove it all because they're trying to just remove the bacteria from the thing. And then they'll graft that area later on. But necrotizing fasciitis doesn't happen here. It just happened last year to two people in Cottage Grove. You see it in the hospital. So these bacteria, the more they're getting these enzymes that are becoming more and more virulent. By the way, before I forget, they don't use streptokinase or scaphokinase anymore for clot busters. They actually use what's called TPA, which is tissue plasminogen activator. So they just give you it, and then if you have a simple lining, it clots off, they'll put that in there to break the clot. But anyway, so these bacteria are getting worse and worse, and nastier and nastier. And by the way, to get that, do you guys know how you get that? You just need two things. You need Streptococcus pyogenes, or different bacteria that causes it, and an injury. And so you need some form of injury and an injury. And so I've got case studies in microbiology where this one lady, her kid was sick with strep throat. And so the kid had strep throat, but they went camping, and when she was camping, she was gonna catch a ball, and she hit her side on a car. And so she injured her side. Well, when she hit her side, what she did is she formed a thrombus in that area. Well, the bacteria had gone into her body from her kid, and the bacteria was circulating, but the bacteria couldn't seed itself onto this endothelium because it was producing prostacyclin. But over here, the bacteria could seed here, and then it gained access out here. And so where she had hit her side, the bacteria came in there, walled itself off, and did the form sensing thing. It grew and grew and grew, and then it released itself through using the streptokinase, and then started producing coagulase and hyaluronidase, and what happened is her side just broke open and started bleeding. And so they had to remove all the tissue on her side.
Okay, question about that?
Yeah.
Was she already immunocompromised?
No. Well, this lady was just because of her, she was